Hey everyone, Danielle with Roger Clark here with Influence Builder. And I'm excited you guys are here because you guys are here for three unknown ways to 3X your sales. And it's supposed to be in 30 days, but the title, I couldn't fit everything in, but 3X your sales in 30 days as a speaker. So I'm super excited you guys are here. I'm going to jump right in. We're going to start the presentation. And don't worry if you can't stay for the whole thing, if you guys can only come in for part of it, or if you're coming in and watching the replay, don't worry, everything's going to be available to you either within the live or on the replay page. So that being said, we're going to jump right in. And I'm going to pull up my slides. There we go. So you guys are here. You're here to learn how to increase your sales as a speaker. So here's what you guys are going to learn. You're going to learn how to unlock those corporate partnerships for quicker gigs. These are some insider strategies that a lot of people don't even know that they can use, but yes, you can use them. And this will get you a high value corporate partnerships. It's not only going to get you in the door, but it could even keep you there, which is the whole point of all this, right? We want to be able to get into some of these corporations, regardless if you're a speaker or trainer, or maybe you're coming in as a consultant. And you want to get some more gigs as a consultant. So these are just some backdoor methodologies that we're going to be teaching you guys. This is also going to help you guys to amplify that branding through optimized marketing assets from a must-have website feature to a one-page sales strategy. You guys really need to know how to supercharge your online presence to be a go-to speaker. So we're going to talk about that really briefly, and then mastering those conversions with some of our optimization techniques. So you guys are going to get some tools. I'm going to show you guys some things. You're going to have some new tools in your toolbox on how to close these high ticket sales. And LinkedIn is perfect for the warm lead generation. So we will talk about outbound, cold, and then inbound warm. And we will use LinkedIn as our go-to for the inbound warm lead generation and marketing. So, okay, guys, we're going to keep moving. We're going to move fast. Okay, so the first thing is that we've got to learn how to make really good first impressions with your marketing assets. It's essential. It is essential, guys. Also, how to get those corporate training and speaking gigs. You don't necessarily have to be a speaker. You could just be a trainer. You could just have a training and get into some of these. You can even be a consultant that has the ability to create a training. Also outbound marketing tactics that are working really, really well. In fact, our outbound and our inbound together are getting anywhere between two to five sales calls per day. So we try not to. Okay, I'm lying a little bit. Sometimes we work on weekends, but we try not to work on the weekends. So 5 days a week is when we have our lead gen going. And so we're anywhere between 10 to 25 sales calls booked per week between us and our clients, and not meaning that combined with all my clients. No, I'm talking about individually as a company and then our independent clients individually, right? I know you guys are like, that's not possible. It's totally possible. It is. Okay, so we're going to talk about inbound marketing tactics, mostly through LinkedIn. Super, super amazing platform. Scaling on autopilot, and then case studies and conclusion. I will try to get through the case. I've tried to get to the case studies. I don't know if I'm going to make it, but I will try. I do talk fast, so we may have a good chance of it. All right, guys, setting the foundation. I talk about this every webinar I have. You guys have to have a goal. You want to have a goal. I'm not going to teach you guys SMART goals or anything like that today, but I like to have a specific measurable goal with whatever we are approaching. So for example, and this is timely based on, you know, today and what's happening next month, we have a goal for our Black Friday sales. So me and my team are actually going to have a meeting this afternoon where we're going to start our nurture campaigns now, right? Month and a half later. Yeah, we're going to start them now. Month and a half later, we're going to have Black Friday, but we are going to start nurturing now. So because we have a very specific goal, but the reason why I say that goals are an amazing piece of the foundation is because we have to have the goals to get to in order to backtrack so that we can have today's conversation, right? So me and my team are having today's conversation on what it is that we need to do to hit the goal that we want to hit in a month and a half. And then you got to know why. Why do we want to hit this goal? So we'll use the Black Friday again. We want to hit this goal because there's a couple of reasons. One is that we want to finish the year big. We've got some big plans for 2024. So The other why is that we want to take, I want to take off at least 2 weeks during Christmas. That's just what I want to do. And so big push in November is going to help me do that. Right. Also, I also know that during December and like November, December after Black Friday, that's when things tend to slow down. That's when, you know, it's really important for me as a business owner to slow down and to start thinking about what are all the things that I want to do in 2024. So there's a lot of big reasons why. And then we create a plan. So me and my team are going to create a plan this afternoon. So I want you guys to take that idea, the goal setting, the reverse engineering, and then the planning piece. I want you to take that with what I'm teaching you today, because it will support you guys in hitting those goals and to really hitting, getting 3x in your sales in 30 days as a speaker. You got to have a plan in place. You got to have some goals to hit. Why do you want to 3x your sales in speaking specifically? Or maybe you don't want a speaker. You're just thinking that I just want to 3x my sales and I'm going to utilize speaking as an opportunity to do that. So always good to start with that. And so if you guys have not met me yet or know about me, I'm Danielle Fitzpatrick Clark, and I did not fix that slide. It definitely messed up, but the Clark is underneath. I am lovingly nicknamed a digital disruptor from my colleagues and clients, but I'm also an international speaker. I'm also a two-time international best-selling author. So who am I to tell you guys this? Well, I know what I'm doing because I've been doing it. So we've been doing this for quite some time, but I have a very unique perspective in what it takes in the online space specifically to disrupt your niche. And we need to do that with messaging. So I am really good at doing that. That is one of my favorite things to do. I'm very good at disrupting niches. I'm very good at disrupting messaging. So it stands out. So that messaging stands out and positions you. So we help people create those iconic brands. We work with iconic brands, and we have experts that hire me to help them create those opportunities online so that they can build massively impactful platforms. Because a lot of the people I work with are thought leaders, influencers, brands, and corporations, but they're not just here for the ROI, although the ROI is very important. They're also here to create a platform that is impactful. So we help do that. I help you get the right leads and the right gigs at the right time with the right people. That's what I do. A little broad, yes, but I can always go into that more. All right, so here's another reason why you want to listen to me. I have worked with some amazing brands. This is only a portion of them, but we've worked with some really amazing brands here in the online space. I'm also an influencer. I know how to go viral. That was one of my favorite campaigns that I have there. I'm also a podcast host. We just found out last week that one of our podcasts has hit the top 10% of most listened to podcasts out of, geez, I want to say 3 to 4 million podcasts. We're in the top 10%. That feels pretty good. I'll feel even better when I get into the top 2%. It's happening. It's going to happen. And then my second podcast, it is well on its way. We are getting thousands of downloads per episode. We just launched it last month. So I don't just say my company's influence builder. I really do work towards being an influencer. And I also get featured. I've been featured in the media quite a bit over the years. This year has been a very big year. So I'm also a LinkedIn top voice in terms of digital marketing. And also I was named one of the top 20 women disruptors to look out for in 2023, and also 40 under 40. And I just got in there before I turned 40 here this summer. So those are some of the publications. So I definitely know a thing or two. And I know, right? I'm bragging about myself. So fetch, so funny. You're so great, Danielle. I'm not trying to brag about myself. Just know that this type of positioning is very important for you as well. I like to not just say to do these things, but I like to show you how to do these things. And so you guys can see I did a little bit of positioning here on the webinar, which is exactly what you guys want to be doing as a speaker, as an expert, especially when you're going into getting paid and getting paid corporate training gigs and speaking, right? Because first impressions, right? They are important. They are important. I wish we didn't live in this world, because I think there's a lot underneath what you can see to people and to companies. However, the world that we live in, first impressions rule. People do get judged by the cover of the book. So what does that mean for your brand? The first impression will be how you are remembered or ignored. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can be ignored too. Your brand and how it looks is either going to give people a reason to continue moving forward towards you or away from you because like that was lame. Yeah, unfortunately that is part of it. So that first impression counts. It counts a lot. It could be the thing that makes or breaks you. It is the deciding factor of whether or not you're going to get a second or a third or a fourth look or no more looks at all. Like, wow, that was a waste of my time. So just know that the first impression is important. And most don't know how to do this well, right? Most don't know how to do this well. You know who else doesn't know how to do this well? Companies, corporations, small businesses, entrepreneurs, speakers, trainers, fractional consultants. They don't know how to do it well. So the best video about this, I'm going to show you guys. Hold on. Let me bring up the video. You guys got to see this. It is funny and scary at the same time. It really is, but it'll give you guys a perspective of how not to make a first impression.
That's the 2 cent tour. So now I can answer any of your questions and give you the 5 cent tour.
We are a smaller brand, much like you talked about being a smaller, you know, movie. Yeah. We're very much a challenger brand, so we don't have the budgets that other brands mm-hmm. have. So doing things like this, you know, remind people about Van is kind of why we're interested in it.
What are the words that you would use to describe Van? Van is blank. It's not the way you want to describe something. Somebody's putting in their armpit.
We talk about bold.
Yeah.
Fresh. Okay. I think fresh is a great word that really spins this category into the positive versus fights odor and wetness. Mm-hmm. Right. It's keeps you fresh.
Fresh.
How do we keep you fresher, longer, better freshness, more freshness, mm-hmm. three times fresher, things like that that are, you know, more of that positive benefit.
And that's a multi-million dollar corporation.
Here we go. Anywho, you guys can probably hear it now. I think it muted me. All right, when I put on the video. Can you guys hear me now? All right, so I want you guys to go ahead and tell me what is unique about what you do. I think you guys can hear me now. So tell me what's unique about you. Okay, good. I see it. Thank you, Elijah. So tell me in the comments what's unique about you. And because this is really important, I didn't really say a whole lot, guys. I didn't. You didn't really miss anything. But I want to just take a moment for you guys to go ahead and tell me in the comments what is very unique about what you do. Because it really is important on how you guys present yourself as a speaker, as a consultant, in any place where you are selling your services. You have to be able to sell yourself. So if you guys can, tell me what is unique about you compared to your competitors, compared to anybody else that could be doing something close to what you do. So I had a lady this morning that she was, and I'll give you guys a second, right? Don't be like the deodorant brand and think about it like, we're fresh or new. Now give me something good, guys. Give me something disruptive. So there was a lady I was talking to this morning where I didn't even have to ask her this question as part of her pitch. She was pitching me. She was telling me what was unique about her. Was it relevant? No, it was not, but that's okay. That's okay. She didn't know the crowd that she'd be speaking to, but it was a really good differentiator. So she knew what made her different is that she modernized old school marketing tactics and brought them into the online space. That's basically what she was doing. She didn't verbalize it like that, but I got the gist of it. And so the gist of it was that I have modernized old marketing tactics that are the most powerful marketing tactics and brought it into the online space. Probably should have told her that's what she needs to do. Okay, I'm going to move on. You guys are thinking about it. Ooh, it doesn't have to be perfect. Give me something. Give me something. Just something. So my whole thing, my pitch is that I have been lovingly nicknamed as a digital disruptor because when everybody else is zigging, I am zagging when it comes to your online marketing sales tactics. That's what I do. Okay. I know you guys can hear me now, so I'm going to move on. I'll keep a lookout on the chat. You guys are being like super shy. Elijah, come on. What makes you different? I know you've got something. I'm going to check back. All right. So let me ask you guys another question here. How do you know that that's the thing that's unique about your business? So one of the things that this lady told me this morning that she knew what she did was unique because why? You've done the work. So you know it's different because you've done the work on your messaging. You've tested and tweaked the messaging. You know you've done a good job. And that was one of the things that she actually communicated was that I know that this is what makes you unique because people told me so. Maybe you had a business coach tell you that you were unique. Maybe a business coach helped you with it. Someone else in your niche uses that as their unique selling proposition. Like, I know this is unique because somebody uses that and I just, you know, tweaked it to me. Or this is the feedback you get from your ideal clients and current clients and past clients. So I will say that the feedback that I get is that I'm a digital disruptor. That's something that people, you know, pegged for me. All right, Elijah says, I walk the walk. My agency builds custom software for startups and Fortune 500 companies. We also build them for ourselves, launch companies, and do it all while unapologetically prioritizing our health and families. Okay, so Elijah, that's really long and that's good. So what it is that, and Alex and Rosie said this, is like, I actually walk the walk. You know, everybody's a talker, but you could actually say, I'm not even just a walker, I'm a runner because I prioritize my health and my family's health. I'm just saying, you could actually say, I don't just walk the walk. I run the walk or I run, and I don't talk. And we know how to build custom software because we always build custom softwares for ourselves. So it's really interesting. And I would even dig into what is it about the customization that is so essential to your startups. And so maybe you've gotten that feedback before too. So there's no wrong or right way to approach any of this. There's no wrong or right way. It's just the process. It all comes down to the results that you're getting from your marketing. So whether or not somebody has told you this is what you are, or a business coach helped you with it, or someone in your niche has a unique selling proposition that you tweaked a little bit for yourself and now you found your own through that, or it's a feedback that you've gotten, there's no wrong or right. It all works as part of the process. And so again, I was the guinea pig, but you know, lovingly nicknamed. Somebody told me I was this. I didn't even know that I was a disruptor. I didn't know that was the right word for me. And it was three people. It was three. Clients agree because I always show them a new way of doing things when it comes to their digital marketing and online sales. So I was already proving it. I was doing what Elijah does and walking the walk. I was proving it. It wasn't just talking about it. Oh, I'm a digital disruptor. Ha ha. Sounds cute, doesn't it? I'm the double D. And my name's Danielle too. So digital disruptor Danielle. No, I was actually doing, I was showing people that I was disruptive and I knew how to think a different way, think differently. And then I have a flair for taking what they are doing, finding the standout features within it and backing it with the market research. So I take that next step and I do the market research and I do my market research in a disruptive way. So like I said, there's no wrong or right. There's just a process in making it work for you. And how do you know it's working? Is that the market responds to it well in a positive way. It gets you clients. It gets you sales. It gets you colleagues. It gets you things like that. So one of the things that I know as a speaker, this is one of the favorite things that hosts like to say when they introduce me. Guys, you guys are in for a treat. We've got Danielle Fitzpatrick-Clark here, and she is a digital disruptor. And what happens after he says it? The comment section lights up. And the comment section is like, ooh, that's a great name. Oh, I can't wait to hear more about how she disrupts. And so, and this the host is excited. They're excited to explain. And boy, do I deliver, because then I get the feedback and I get the feedback on stage. I get the feedback from the audience that, boy, she certainly does know how to turn things on their head. She is definitely the digital disruptor when it comes to this. We're so glad to have stuff like that. That's your feedback. Can it be, does it have to be live? No, but it does help if it's live. And then here's the other thing. If you guys are still trying to tweak that and still trying to learn from it, ask, get the live feedback. What did you guys think? What did you guys think of this? What was your biggest takeaway from what I just shared with you? Those kind of things. And so I've gotten my messaging down to a point where it's not that I'm trying to be cultish or anything like that, but I do have people that when they meet me, or even if it's just for a few minutes or they listen to me speak, I have them saying, this is what we do, guys. We zag when everyone else is zigging. So I don't want you guys to zig. What do I want you guys to do? I want you to zag. I want you guys to be your own digital disruptors. And so I have them, I have molded myself into their minds. They're always going to remember me that way. First impressions count. They count. And then you got to do what Elijah does. And then you have to walk the walk or run the walk. You got to show them. You got to prove it to them. You're not just a name. You've got a reason why you're called that. Okay, now it's your turn. So I want you guys to take just 30 seconds and write down the first thing that comes to mind. First thing that comes to mind, don't overthink it. We are so good at overthinking. We are, especially if we're highly, highly creative. So what is the one unique and even weird, you guys can be weird on this, right? Thing that you are good at. It can be something weird. Like, I am really good at picking the best mushrooms in the supermarket. Every time I pick them and cook, my family is just, they're just astounded by like, how do you get these mushrooms? It could be weird. Like I said, that could be something because we can use it. We can use it. We can always use it. So ask yourself the answer to that. How do you use that in your program, product, service, training offerings? How can you use that? Can you use it? And so here's what I would say. We'll use the mushroom again. Just like, guys, I have this ability to pick the very best mushrooms whenever I go to the grocery store, and they turn out beautifully when I decide to create something like stuffed mushrooms. And so here's what I know because of that one experience is that I am really good at taking people who may not be well-known or may not be seen as anything amazing and turning them into something amazing that nobody even expected. I turn what is unexpected into something amazing. So you could always turn that as well in that product and service that you offer using that story. Like I said, it can be weird. How does that one thing create results for your ideal client? So ask yourself that. How does it create results? So because I'm really good at picking out mushrooms and I'm able to say, this is what I do, I'm really good at being able to pick out the beautiful things that you do within your offerings. This is going to help you get results when you learn to use this in your messaging and to move this forward as a speaker as well. Right? So take 30 seconds, do that, We're going to move on. Don't worry. You guys can watch the replay. But just don't overthink it. It could be something so simple. I don't know where the mushroom one thing came out, guys. It just came to me, and so I just went with it. But it's stuff like that. I didn't think about it. I didn't overthink about it. All right. So you've got it. Awesome. If you don't worry. You can come back to it. Now you've got a position. You've got to position this. Now you want to position what it is that you have a fantastic ability in. So in your about section, so on social media, your website, in your other marketing assets that you use to get in front of ideal clients and corporations, you want to go ahead and position that. Like I said, it can be weird. People like weird. I like weird. I like weird stuff. And then create testimonials around it where they say, they have a saying, this is your X factor. So digital disruption, that's a really good one. People just know that that's how they see me as that, and they know that I'm going to help them stand out, right? And maybe I use the mushroom thing as a way to take something very simple and something that unexpected and turning it into the standout, right? I could probably put that on my social media after this. I could. So what's an example? Danielle has this uncanny way of turning our preconceived weakness into a strength that's not only memorable, but showcases how powerful we are as an asset to any corporation. That's an actual testimonial from a client where she, and there's a great story that goes with this, but she was up for some major awards, and it was a couple of years ago, and she had a past. She had a past. We all have a past, right? And they weren't even skeletons in her closet. Just she hadn't really owned the fact that she was a lawyer. She got disbarred. She became homeless. There's a whole story beyond that. And she was going for this award. They reached back out to her and they saw some of these things in her online presence. And they asked about it. Like, as we're considering all this, we wanted to ask you, we saw that you got disbarred. So they asked her about that. And so she sends me the email and she messages me on WhatsApp and says, it's over. It's over. And I'm like, what do you mean? Well, what's over and why are you saying that? And so she told me and I said, listen, and I get really like mother lioness here when I'm just like, no, nobody's messing with you. Trust me. And so I said to her, I think that you need to flip the switch on what this is, because you're sitting here thinking that it's over. And I'm saying it's just begun, because these guys are giving you the opportunity to pitch yourself. And she actually is a pitch master. I'm like, so show them what you're made out of, because you have been given a golden opportunity to not only show them how great you are pitching, because you're going to pitch yourself in this one, but to also take ownership of your past and what it took for you to get to where you are now. And you're pretty freaking phenomenal right now. Guess what, guys? She did it. She came in second into that massive award. Second. When she thought it was over, she got second place. She's like, I know it's not first place. I know we were going for first place, coach, but I'm like, are you kidding me? Second place is amazing. You're going to get first place next year, which I believe she did get first place next year. But it was that piece where she thought it was over. I was like, nope, it's just starting. And then she got gigs off of that. She got gigs. So think of it that way, guys. Think of it as turning what you may think is weird about yourself or a weakness, and then turning that into the thing that differentiates you. So it's just another example. It's just another example of what you can use. You can use all the things, right? He had an actual like mind blowing up, right? It was a cartoon, but it was like mind blown, right? I really wish my gifts would have come through on this one. That's okay. All right. So lead generation for getting corporate clients. There are two main methods that we use that we know work really well. There's the warm outreach. It works. It does. And then there's the cold outreach. I like to use both. Both work so well together. So warm outreach. Networking is warm outreach, right? Referrals is warm outreach. Affiliates are warm outreach. So you can have people going out and getting you gigs. You know, there's speaker bureaus and stuff that will do that if you're a speaker. Your business partners can do that. Influential partnerships, the thought leaders within your industry, they can be your affiliates, JV partnerships. And then, of course, you can also hire people to be your affiliate. So all those things. Referrals are great as well. So client to client. So people who you're a client of, or even that are clients of you, they can refer you. They can refer you colleagues and or mentors as well. Networking. So this is what I say about warm outreach when it's networking, is that you want something to be very industry specific. And it doesn't have to, that's if it's in person. If it's on in person, social media conversations are great too for networking. Okay, so that's our warm outreach. I also want to throw in there that social media, I mean, any kind of warm outreach on social media to get to know people is a really good way. So cold outreach, so emailing. Emailing's a great cold outreach to have. It, and this is what I like about cold outreach, guys, and when it's email marketing versus advertising. Because advertising, especially if you're doing like Facebook ads, Google ads, LinkedIn ads, that kind of stuff, it is considered cold outreach because you're putting your information in front of somebody who didn't necessarily ask for it, right? So cold emailing is kind of that thing too. Now, can you do it in everywhere? No, you can't. You can't do it everywhere. You definitely can't do it in Canada. They have to, there's can spam law. The UK as well. Brazil is another one. I want to say there's another one, but everywhere else, you're good. You have to have like an unsubscribe or something underneath that, or somewhere where people can unsubscribe. But the thing I like about this versus advertising is that it's highly, highly targeted. You can choose who you do cold outreach to. You can scrape all this stuff online, guys. You can get the emails from lead brokers, and you can mainly find emails via social media. Great, right? You guys can also do cold outreach through phone calls. So, and yes, it's still done. I met somebody 2 weeks ago who he's like, I have a list that I paid a broker for with 1,000 emails and phone numbers. And I said, oh, are you cold emailing them? Like, no, I'm calling all of them. And so this guy, 15 hours straight, because he had certain things he had to fill and he was in his sales process, 15 hours straight, phone calls. That's a lot, right? Good news is that it can be highly targeted. You can scrape them online, you can get them from brokers, all that good stuff. The other thing is that you guys can do direct message. So direct message sometimes can be cold, especially if you haven't connected with somebody, but groups are a good way to discover who you want to message. What I say with this kind of cold outreach, and this is just so we can not just target, but also have an understanding, is like look for interest specific groups, because you want to actually have somebody respond to you. So if you're doing cold outreach, make sure that you are within a place where you can have a conversation and turn it into more warm. So what does that mean? Is that it's a lot easier to connect with somebody on LinkedIn, for example, when you guys are in the same group or have a common interest, and saying that within that connection message, right? Versus somebody that you just click the connect button and nothing else. So find interest-specific groups, be parts of those groups, and then reach out, connect that way. Is it cold? It is, especially if you don't know them. But you guys can also do some cold outreach and searching for them by just searching their titles. You can look at hashtags to find the right people to reach out to. Written content is also great. So you can look at any written content and see who wrote it. You can even find these guys on Facebook ads. But I would say even if you want to look at your competitors and see who's liking and commenting that, it's a pretty good indication that that could be your ideal client as well. So that's how you find them. That's how you do that. SMS texting, highly targeted. We have a whole SMS campaign hooked to our Facebook ads. And so what that does is that not only do we email these guys when we do a lead form with our lead magnet, but we also text message them. So again, it can be highly targeted as well. And you can scrape these guys online, getting that from broker, mainly find them on social media, or you can run ads too. It's still cold outreach, right? Some people do voicemail as well with their cold outreach. This is one of the things that Alex Hormozy, who is really big in the lead generation field, does. He does voicemail as well. We don't do voicemail. There's a couple of different really cool applications out there if you wanted to use AI. I think AI or Air AI is another one where they'll leave voice messages or they'll actually do the cold calls for you. So all those good things. You can scrape again the phone numbers online. You can run ads and get those phone numbers. That's one of the things that we do. We want people to self-select in. It's just our process. Get them from brokers, the phone numbers, manually find them on social media as well. But there's the thing. I gave you all these methodologies, right? But none of this actually works unless you have this one thing and you have this first. Trust. You need the trust. So whether the prospect trusts you or they trust the person who recommended you, you've got to get this first. So I've got so many different examples of this too. But you know, trust is a little bit easier when there's warm outreach, right? So if this is a networking opportunity, if this is something where it's a referral, so somebody they know that they have a warm connection with refers you, then you get some of that warmth as well. You get some of that trust. And so you just have to have the trust. You have to have the trust. It really does help with everything moving along. But with the cold, it's a little harder to build the trust. It just is. So sending somebody a cold email or a DM where they don't know you, they don't know anything about you, it's a little harder to gain. And boy, do you break that trust very, very quickly if you just pitch them. Now, advertisements a little bit different, because part of them signing up for like a social media platform is that they are going to get pitched. So they already know, but what's on you is to build that trust within the advertisement. That's what it is. So how do you build it? Well, first thing you got to do is you got to build rapport. You got to build rapport with a relationship. You got to be relatable. So whether it's colleagues, clients, mentors, new networking buddies, cold prospects, you got to build rapport. You got to be relatable. You got to be relatable. Always make it about them first. So this is what I see a lot going wrong in the online space, is that people are just not making it about the person they're talking to, and they're doing all the talking. So what do they need to do differently? And I actually talked to two digital marketing companies yesterday when I was asking them about their marketing strategies, and they're like, we've tried everything and nothing works. And so we went into the aspect they needed my help with, and I asked them pretty plainly. I'm like, okay, so I probably know the answer to this, but just tell me your process when you're DMing people on LinkedIn. Well, we connect with them, but we pitch them immediately. I'm like, okay, well, that's your problem then. That's the problem. They don't trust you. They don't know you. They don't trust you. You can have the best looking website with all the SEO that you want, but because you came in and pitched first, they don't trust you and they don't like you now. So how do you get, and I said, and the reason that you guys did that, I'm just going to say it, is because you didn't make it about them and what their needs and wants were first. It was about you. It was about you getting the sale. And they knew it. Nobody wants to be that notch on your belt or that number within your list. So how do we flip that? We personalize. So instead of somebody sending out like a LinkedIn DM where it's just like, hey, if you need X, Y, and Z, I'm your person. Connect with me and I'll tell you more. I'm like, awesome. Great. That's exactly what I want. Is I want 40 messages from the same person within 2 minutes each today. Nope. Decline. No way. But if you personalize that connection message on LinkedIn and say, hey, it looks like we're in this group together and we're both podcast hosts, I'd love to get linked up here on LinkedIn to see how we can collaborate. Ooh, I'm down for that. I can do that. So personalization, you guys want to give first. You want to give first, especially if in that particular relationship, you're the one that's moving towards them. It's cold messaging, cold emailing, all those things. You want to give them something first, right? And understand how to make them look good. That's the other thing. So if they're not necessarily looking for ROI, they're not looking to just get what they need, maybe you're just offering to make them look good. And how do you make them look good? Well, you get them visible, or you get them something that puts them out there in front of more people. So one of the things that we use with our connection requests on LinkedIn that works really, really well is that we just say, I'm like, hey, I'm the host of this podcast. Works really well with other podcast hosts. But in the mind of everybody, they're like, ooh, it'd be really great to get to know her and see if I'm a good fit for her podcast. Some people will come right out and just like, I'd love to be on your podcast. I'm like, well, if you want to be on that one, I actually don't interview, you know, consultants. I interview celebrities. So, I mean, it's kind of that piece of like, well, at least I know where their head's at. And just like, they didn't even listen to anything. So this isn't going to be a good conversation at all, but I can't help them on that either. But you know what I mean? They are looking to look good. So how do you make them look good? Can you offer them something that makes them look good? Maybe it's just that you do just value first and you give them value, or show them where to go, or send them to somebody that can help them. All right, so here's how to give massive value. Lead magnets are great. Again, I'm quoting Alex. His stuff is brilliant when it comes to lead gen. Make it so good people feel stupid for saying no. I get so good. They feel stupid for saying no. I know. I mean, nobody's going to say no. If they do, then they're missing out. So free discovery calls are really great. Introductions. So when you're networking, can you introduce them to somebody? Anything that you think would blow their mind. Like, oh, that's amazing. That's amazing. So glad that you gave this to me. And I usually will, if I'm doing any kind of networking, I'll usually ask really good questions and find out what's going on and say, oh, well, here's how I would problem solve that. And then their minds are blown. Like, oh, geez, how do I talk to you, Danielle, about working with you? Is usually what they'll say. And like, well, that's another conversation. This one was just for us to build some rapport, which makes them like me even more because I'm not trying to sell them anything. So sometimes I go right into it because they like, no, I really want, before we get off the call, I want to know your offerings and how I can work with you. So just know that stuff, but don't do this. Like, this is the thing I don't want you guys to do when you're doing some cold outreach. So don't blatantly try to fix anything. Like, ask really good questions and problem solve, but don't try to fix. There's a difference between problem solving, because that's more about communication and collaboration, versus fix. Fix is something that they may have not have asked for, that you're just saying, this is wrong. You're doing this wrong. You need to do this right. This is my way or the highway. It's just what people hear. Words have a lot of power. You have to use them very wisely. So don't try to blatantly fix them or their company in any way if they haven't first shared with you their specific pain points. Like I said, you're not trying to fix anybody. You're trying to problem solve. You're trying to collaborate and help them and give them solutions. But don't assume. Don't assume that you know. Even if their website stinks and you're the best website developer out there, you can't say to them, you need to fix your website. This is terrible. You're losing money like this. Don't do it. Just don't do it. Ask really good questions. Have them tell you what they think their problems are. Have them tell you. They may not even know that their website stinks, right? Or that their application, that their mobile app stinks. They may not even know. Trust me, I've come across that where people have an app of some sort or a product or a SaaS product. And I tell them, like, guys, you know that this customer journey stinks. It does not go over well. It never goes over well. They have to know. They have to know that it stinks before you can say, I'm glad that you said that. I did notice that. So it's agree with whatever they say. Don't disagree, especially if they're the ones that are, you know, they have the thing that you want. You need to agree. Let them self-select in. If you don't do this, then this will take you right back to the beginning. And most likely there is no beginning because that bridge is already burned. Okay. So a little bit of meatloaf in here for you. I would do anything for love from these guys, but I promise, Neil, I won't do that. I won't do that. Good. I'm glad. So here's the truth about trust. Those who are warm to you won't need as much from you. Those who are cold to you will need a ton from you. You need to blow their minds. So keep that in mind. Those that are cold to you will need a ton from you. They will need a ton. But there's only so much time in the day. So what do you do? What do you do? How do you build rapport? Well, you automate your personalization, both warm and cold. You selectively network with your warm audience. Don't network with everybody, guys, especially if you only have so much time and you still have to do fulfillment and sales and marketing. Your team's not built out. Be very selective with your networking. Hub your value. So give away the things for free that most people would charge for. That's another. I think that's something else that Alex says too. I was already on board, like all the things that he has. I'm like, yes, that's what we do. I'm so glad that somebody else is talking about this. Now I just need to get as big as him and put my own little twist on it, because there is a twist on it that he didn't cover. And I'm like, ooh, that could be my thing. But hub your value, give away the things for free, but put it into a hub. If you want to automate this, or you don't have time to kind of just like, I have like four different trainings that everybody needs each piece of that training. So I'm going to put it into like a little membership community. They can come into that portal for free. No problem. Here's the link to the portal. Just come on in and watch it. You need this. Oh, drop your email if you want me to send you more stuff. So they can go through the process. It's automated. It's personalized based on what they need. You put it into a hub and now they can get more information on how you work, right? You want to hook them. You want to hook them. You want them to binge watch your stuff like Netflix binge watch. That's what you want to do. Without you having to do anything, because like I said, there's only so much time in the day. So here's how I do each. Automation, get a good CRM. Kartra is a really good CRM, guys. And you guys can try it out for 14 days for free if you want. I have a link for you. Don't worry. I will have it on the page. I will send everybody this replay. the cold emailing works really amazing. Now, they have changed this up in the last few weeks. So register for a different domain than your main website domain, domains.google.com. What it's going to do is it's going to send you to Squarespace. It is, I know. You can still do what you need to do right through Squarespace, get that domain, and then you just have to go through a couple of different extra steps where you have to use Google in order to get your email, but you can do all of that right there. So cold emailing is really great. Just make sure that whichever domain you're using, it is not the same as your main website. Automation, register. Alumnus is really good for automation. Instant.ai is really good. Instantly.ai is really good as well. And you can connect all those email addresses and step-by-step guide. I've tried out both of them. Alumnus does a really good job of integrating within LinkedIn. But honestly, I think that Instantly is, I'm starting to love on them a little bit more because it's just a little more user-friendly. So also, guys, you guys want to use LinkedIn automation. You just do. So LinkedIn automation tools, we have a private label. So we have something that's privately labeled within a, within our company. And so we use that. It's amazing. But for only our clients are able to use that because it's white labeled in and we have our programs. They have to be part of our programs in order to use that. But if you want to do this on your own, and you're like, I don't know enough about your program to get it today, but I want to get started today. Totally get it. Expandy.io is really good. So you guys can actually, it's actually the hardest, the highest rated according to Google. So if you want to do some LinkedIn automation, which I would highly recommend, Expandy.io is a good one. Don't worry, all these links are going to be underneath the replay. So automation, where to use it. You can use it in your cold emailing, your LinkedIn connecting, your DM messaging on social, especially that first welcome message, you can definitely use it there. And then a pro level Air AI if you want to do cold phone calls. I'm working with these guys a little bit, but what I will say is that if you're going to do the cold phone calls within your automation, be very strategic about it. Don't have just like, oh, I have a list of 40 phone numbers. I'm just going to blast all of them and here's the script. No. There's other ways of doing it that work really well in the online space where as everything's improving in AI, you want to do things like this that are just, it just gives you another level or another layer of high touch. That's kind of what you want to use this for. So that's what I would recommend it for. I can always talk to you guys about that too if you want to. Automation, how to keep it personalized when you're using technology, right? So make your requests and subject headers all about them again. Goes right back to making it all about them. LinkedIn, hey, first name. I see that we're in the same group and put that LinkedIn group name. And I have some first, and we have some first degree connections in common. So this is perfect for your second degree connections. Let's connect and see how we can network and collaborate. Personalize within LinkedIn group name, the LinkedIn group name, right? It's also personalized because they're second degree connections. And so you definitely have first degree connections in common. I know, right? He's great, isn't he? Okay, so cold email. What's an example of this? So within that headline, cold email is tough. If you can get somebody to open up a cold email from you, you've done a good job. That actually, you really need to use that headline over and over and over again. So first name, so you can merge that. 3x sales goals in 2023. Worth a chat. I want to know how to 3x my sales goal. I mean, they may open it just to say, no, thanks, never email me again. That's fine. Most of them like, yeah, that sounds amazing. Definitely want to do that. All right. So if you're going to DM message them on social media, this can actually also be a cold email. So you can use this for DM. You can use this for cold email. Hey, first name, hope you're doing well. I came across something interesting that made me think of you and your role at and the company name. You can merge these two guys with an email if you want to. What would you say if I told you there's a way to potentially 3x your sales team's goals by the end of 2023? Intrigued. I've been working on something exciting and new. So all those things that you guys, I mean, the first name, the company name, you can merge those in. Let me just check this real quick. I'm on desktop. Okay, awesome. Okay, cool. Yes, email me the recording. I thought you were asking for this recording. Yes, Elijah, go ahead and email me that. All right, so that's a really good example, guys, of how you can message us. Now, you guys can use this messaging when you are actually pitching corporate gigs too. Now, you can if you are in sales and you are a sales trainer, you could actually use a lot of this for yourself. All right. So selective networking. I'm going to move through this one. I think I covered this one pretty well. Triple wins. Yeah. Yeah. These are really great to getting these speaking gigs, right? All right. And hubbing the value is also really good. Creating the hub, choose a platform about the journey, all this good stuff. All right. So I want to summarize this a little bit. So all the things I told you to do, this is through lead generation. Now, when it comes to corporate speaking, the best way that we have found to get in front of corporate speaking gigs is to actually not go against momentum. So one of the things, and I don't have the exact stats numbers, but I'm gonna you know, round up here. Between 2022 and 2023, training, so learning and development for corporations, privately held corporations mostly, we're talking about a $3 to $4 billion industry, learning and development within these corporations. Yeah, it's huge, huge. And so this is actually doubled in the last couple of years. It is set to double in the next 2 to 3 years as well. So double what it's doing now. This is the budget. This is the budget. This is how much money is being spent on this stuff. So when you guys are thinking about, I'd like a piece of this pie, please. Yes, please. I want to get paid to speak. You know, learning and development, trainings and speaking opportunities, they are very, very well funded by corporations. Now, the ones that are doing really well, the industries, the training within these industries that are doing really well, especially moving into 2024, as you probably already guessed this, but yeah, AI, anything to do with AI, anything to do with digital, really. So digital marketing, digital sales, that kind of stuff. So marketing and sales still stands, people, especially sales, people really want to understand how do I do this? The other thing that's really improving as well, and this was nice to see, but health and wellness. So if you are a speaker and you're a health and wellness speaker, you can actually train in corporations. They're looking for, it's not just like your health and wellness with your body, but it's your mind too. So mindset, leadership is big. So those are the types of things that people in training directors within corporations are looking for, that type of stuff, and they have the budget for it. So when you guys are pitching, if you are pitching, you want to look for companies that are already looking for those types of trainers or those types of consultants or those types of high-level employees that are trying to hire that already. Then you just pitch them, well, have you thought about bringing in a consultant or a trainer or a speaker to give this one piece of it? Then you get to start pitching yourself and your uniqueness, right? So cold emailing works really great for that. LinkedIn marketing works really great to get in front of the decision makers of corporations and the L&D directors as well. So you want to get really good at that stuff. So all this stuff works within the pitching for speaking. Now, when you can automate it, this is what I love. When you can automate these things, you can work faster. So we have automation going for a lot of different things. It is cold outbound emailing. It's also advertising. It's also, we have warm inbound. So we have developed a pretty large LinkedIn platform. And so we are able to do some reach out that is more warm, because we know they're connected with us already. So that works really well. But when you combined all of those different avenues of marketing and sales, then that's when you start really, really, really building out your sales pipeline. So you don't want to just do one, guys. You want to get good at doing as many as you can handle at one time. The best way to handle them is to have automation. It's to have automation going, and just make sure whatever automation you use, you personalize it and you customize it as much as possible to the person that's receiving it. So take Kelly. So she came from corporate. She tried to do the entrepreneurial thing. She did. She worked with coaches. She worked with coaches. She actually lost money. She was not ready for the coaching industry. She wasn't. They needed her. They did. But then she's like, you know what? I have a corporate background. I'm going to go after corporations instead. So she used our LinkedIn. She joined our business sales accelerator. So we brought her in to do not just training, but really she started with us to do lead gen. But she created a niche brand off of that, targeted specific companies who are either focused on education and or tools for educational institutions. So we got her consulting gigs and we also got her training gigs. She actually backdoored in through training. Then she upgraded with them into consulting. First 30 days, she had two 40K contracts and three fractional consulting gigs. Yeah, so she did really, really well, right? Okay, so Michael, so he didn't necessarily come in as a trainer. He did end up training for a couple of these, and it was just to give him a taste. So he was one of those people that was more, he left corporate because he had one high ticket client, right? He didn't want to be a one-hit wonder. In fact, he said stuff like that all the time. He's like, I don't want this to be my only thing. And I will say, guys, so maybe you resonate with this, maybe you don't. But for anyone that comes out of corporate because they have one client that is paying all their bills, it is actually very, very stressful. It's very, very stressful. You don't necessarily have the stress of being in corporate and all the politics that go along with corporate, but you have the stress of only having the one. It's a lot. So it is not a great place to be in as a consultant or a business owner. It just isn't. So what he did is he used our LinkedIn sales system. We had him in our business sales accelerator, and we created a no-brain lead magnet. Tons of value. He gave a ton of value for 30 days. He even did free trainings. It's a backdoor effect. First 90 days, he got two 50K contracts, and then he got a $500 contract. Yep, pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. Monica did come from corporate. She decided to go narrow and deep. So, and she massively increased her price points. She did a backdoor as well. She used all the same systems. They work in so many different ways. There's so many different angles we can use with our systems. Five 25K contracts and three 50K contracts within 60 days. Pretty amazing, yeah? All right, so inbound marketing, you need amazing content. You just need amazing content and jaw-dropping content. So here are some hooks. Don't worry, the hooks will be there for you, but they work. They work so well. All right, guys. So the conclusion is we talked to you about lead generation, the missing piece, how to win, how to scale, tools and technology, case studies. I went through those briefly. And of course, now we're at the conclusion. Big value add. Below this video, you're going to have the links to all the tools that I suggested and some hooks, right? Okay. You guys are also going to see something from me where you can jump on a call. So if you guys are ready to get consulting gigs, if you're ready to get speaking gigs, training gigs fast, we got something for you. So you guys can go ahead and jump on a phone call with me. And I believe I have the offer here. Yeah, go ahead. You guys can click to schedule a call. So you should see that. There are 10 available, maybe not. It's been a little crazy, guys. Like I said, we're not just joking when we say we're getting 2 to 5 sales calls a day as we are, and I got to bring in another salesperson here ASAP. But you guys can go ahead and schedule that call. If you're watching the replay, there should be a button below. But we can help you guys get these gigs. We can help you get consulting gigs. We can help you get speaking gigs, training gigs, all those things. So we can definitely help you for wherever you are at, but it is definitely worth a 15-minute discovery call with us for me to at least point you in the right direction, right? So we can help you do that. And I think I am just about ready to get off air and get booted here by Kartra because I am almost out of time. So I'm just going to double check and see if I have any questions. Stop slides. There we go. Offers. We're good. Strategies to build a LinkedIn audience follows. Oh, yes, I can definitely do that. So a course on strategies to build a LinkedIn audience follows plus connections. Yeah, LinkedIn is like super easy for us. So since most of these are like, yeah, asking for a friend, I can tell you how I'm addressing it, but I'm no expert. Nice, Alicia. You're so welcome, Bob. I'm glad. I hope you enjoyed. Yeah, LinkedIn, it is its own social media platform. There are so many tactics that you can, I try to train on LinkedIn as much as I can. So I'm teaching people how to utilize the platform the right way. But I will say for the rest of this year and maybe into next year with LinkedIn, you guys want to get really good at overcoming objections. If you struggle with sales at all, just try to DM people on LinkedIn and overcome those objections. So that's my suggestion. I think that's it for now. They're going to boot me off air here any second if they haven't yet. But yes, I do have LinkedIn trainings. You can build a LinkedIn audience really fast. We actually, Funny enough, we're talking about Alex. His company almost hired me to do LinkedIn, but they wanted me to give up my company. I'm like, no way. But it was specific for LinkedIn before. This was a few months ago before the launch. And they wanted my strategies. I'm like, no, no, that's proprietary information. You guys got to pay me a lot of money for that. But you guys can actually build your LinkedIn very, very quickly. And there are strategies to do that. And we do that. So helping you go viral, yes. Helping you get out there more, yes. Helping you get more connections, yes. Helping you get more followers, yes. Helping you get to be a top voice on LinkedIn, yes. We do all those things. So if any of you guys are interested in LinkedIn, if you jump on a 15-minute call, I can talk to you guys about those strategies as well, because LinkedIn is a big one for us when it comes to thought leadership. Okay? All right. I'm going to leave because I know they're going to boot me here any second. And I hope you guys enjoy. Grab a call. We will talk soon. Bye for now.